All right, so we are flying. And obviously we're flying the Skyhunter. Well, if it's not obvious, now it should be. We're flying the Skyhunter. I'm not real sure what we're gonna do on this flight. I just wanted to get something in the air, and why not the Skyhunter? Because I haven't flown it in a while. So I just thought it'd be fun to kind of take it out and put a little bit of flight time on it, get a little bit of time in the air with it. Obviously I had plans. I was supposed to be doing some more Ardu plane stuff at this point, but we got a hurricane recently, Hurricane Delta. It kind of disrupted everything. We went for, I think, 3 days, and just before the fourth night in a row without electricity, we got electricity back. So that was kind of, I don't know, kind of an inconvenience to say the least. But yeah, so what I want to do right now is I'm actually flying a with a relay on my Dragonlink. Actually, I can pull this up where you can see what my webcam. See, I'm just using the little 2.4 antenna on my RadioMaster TX16S. No module in the back, obviously. My Dragonlink transmitter is actually mounted up there on the wall where you can't see it. I will overlay a picture, an image of it. I just wanted to kind of set my cruise throttle here. Set it to around 7-ish amps. I'm flying with a GoPro and a single 4S 5000, so we're not really heavy. So I think about a 7.5. Let's set it around 7.5. That should work. And we're going to lock the throttle there. So that's where my throttle is going to remain as far as we're just cruising around. But yeah, I'll talk some more about the Dragonlink in another future video, because I'm not 100% sure on my setup yet. I'm kind of just feeling it out right now, seeing how well it is or is not going to work. But so far it seems to work fine with all the ground testing that I've done. There's a little small issue with the failsafe, but we'll get into that later. But right now I'm actually going to start a waypoint mission. So yeah, we can set the transmitter right over here and pretty much just enjoy the rest of the flight. You can kind of see the outline of the waypoints on the screen there. Let me go back to full screen on this. This is pretty similar to the waypoint mission that we flew with the Dart XL enhanced version with the Ardu plane running on the F405 wing board. We're just gonna kind of shoot out. Well, obviously we're right on top of a waypoint right now. But as soon as we get to that one, it's gonna kind of veer over to the right a little bit, head over that weed patch, kind of around that little block of woods that is kind of off the left side of the screen right now, or in the left side of the screen rather. And then just kind of shoot around back, follow pretty much the same path that we did in that other flight. That was, I don't know, a few weeks ago now, I believe. But anyway, I just kind of wanted to have something to let it do. So yeah, with Dragonlink, I have the Dragonlink module is mounted up high on my wall. It's mounted in a little 3D printed cradle that I made. And I'm getting the signal from the TX16S into the Dragonlink. I have the Radio Master, my transmitter is bound to a FreeSky XRS receiver. I believe that's the right model, number, name, letters, whatever. But yeah, I'm just running just regular FreeSky 2.4 to it. And then it is injecting S-Bus into the Dragonlink, and then the Dragonlink sends the signal to the receiver, and then the receiver sends S-Bus out to the vector. But like I said, there is a small issue with the failsafe, because with the failsafe settings, in my vector, I have it set to detect the failsafe via the S-Bus signal, and the receiver is set to, in a lost signal condition situation, when it loses signal, it's set to just send no pulses to the vector. So when the vector sees that S-Bus signal stop, then it knows that the receiver is in failsafe, and it triggers a failsafe. The problem is, if the link between my transmitter and the 2.4 receiver on the wall should go down, Obviously, I'm not going to get a lot of, like, physical distance or anything between it, but if something should fail or whatever, and that signal goes down, and the S-bus going into the Dragonlink stops, then the Dragonlink doesn't really detect it. It doesn't detect a failsafe on its input pins. So it just keeps happily transmitting the last good signal that it received, and the airplane never goes into failsafe. So to remedy that, I set up, instead of just no pulses on the Free Sky receiver, I set it to go to custom channel positions. I'm gonna pan over real quick. I wanna take a look at some of this farm equipment that's sitting out here in the field. We were cutting beans earlier today. Getting back to the relay setup. In the failsafe situation on the 2.4 link on the relay, it will go to custom channel positions, which will manually trigger a return to home as if I had flipped the return to home switch, the mode switch, into return to home. So, like I said, I should never have to worry about that. I should not see a failsafe on the relay link, but if something ever does, if a wire breaks, or if the transmitter quits working, or I forget to charge a battery and it dies, or whatever, for any reason, if that link ever goes down, then, you know, I'll manually basically trigger a failsafe that way. Or trigger a return to home, rather. So I don't really want to test that just yet, at least not this far from home. But I will do some more testing with that, make sure everything works as expected. One thing I was worried about is having different models bound to that same Free Sky receiver that's acting as a relay. You know, obviously each model I have, I fly a lot of different models and they're using different flight controllers and things. They're set up different, and my failsafe needs are going to be different from one model to the next. So I'm kind of looking back over the wing at the sunset right now. But so when I switched models, I wasn't sure how I was going to be able to handle that as far as failsafe needs being different. But I found out if I bind each model to the same receiver, or I don't actually need to bind them, I just bound it to one model. And I set a receiver, I just set it to receiver number 01. And then if I just set each receiver up to the same protocol and everything and use the same receiver number being 01, then they're already bound, I don't need to bind them. And using custom failsafe models carries over, or it sticks with each model rather. It doesn't carry over, it doesn't move. When you switch models, the failsafe positions in the receiver actually change according to that model if you have a custom failsafe positions set up for each model. So that handles that. That's one thing I wasn't sure how it was going to work around, but it seems Free Sky's already thought about that. So that works. And just using custom failsafe positions for each one, and when I switch models, it updates the failsafe positions in the receiver. I don't have to do anything, just switch to the model and get it ready to fly it. And one thing in the testing, I thoroughly tested this setup on the ground before I flew it. But in the testing, I did notice that if I switch the model in the transmitter and then immediately go and trigger a failsafe, like turn the transmitter off, within about the first 30 seconds or so, it will still go back to the failsafe positions from whatever previous model was loaded. So I guess it takes a minute to actually send those failsafe positions to the receiver to update them in the receiver itself. So normally it shouldn't be an issue. Kind of looking to see a bird flying down there over the trees. But normally it shouldn't be an issue, because obviously it takes you more than 30 seconds to get your airplane ready to fly anyway. So as long as it's bound up and working on the ground before you fly, it's going to send the updated channel positions. Kind of tempted to cancel this waypoint mission and go fly that bayou a little bit, follow it a little ways. It's pretty interesting, the water low like that. But anyway, we're just going to let the waypoint mission continue. So now we're just kind of skirt the corner of this field and head out to the clearing and then back home to a return to launch. But yeah, getting back to what I was saying, it just be aware that it does take a minute, about 30 seconds or so, to update the failsafe positions, channel positions in the receiver or the relay link. But other than that, it's 100% seems to be working. Like I said, I'll probably do a video you know, a specific video on the relay and how I set it up. It's very simple. It's nothing too complicated about it or nothing unique, but I know some people are going to ask for details on how I set it up and how I did this and that, or what I set this to or whatever. So I'll probably go ahead and do that at some point. But besides getting the UHF transmitter off of my radios, like I said, with the T16, the jumper T16, and the RadioMaster TX16S, I was never able to 100% solve the issue with UHF noise affecting the transmitter itself. Now, with the added shielding in the back cover of the radio, I was able to get it usable and workable, but it's still, you had to be careful you didn't get the antenna too close, angled too close to the radio, or some of your control inputs would get kind of jittery and stuff like that. But with it being mounted, it's, I don't know, a good 10 or 12 feet away from the radio the way I'm sitting here right now, and it's perfectly fine. There's no issues with the radio at all. And it gets that extra battery drain off of the radio, which the Dragonlink doesn't drain a lot of power anyway, but just one last thing to worry about, because it's actually being powered off of my ground station battery. I run everything off of a 3S 5000 LiPo, and it lasts for several days of flying. I'm running the Eagle Eyes diversity controller and my two video receivers, and now the Free Sky receiver and the Dragonlink module are all running off of that 12 volt setup. And I'm actually stepping down the 12 volts to, the 3S LiPo anyway. I'm stepping that down to 9 volts with a little adjustable voltage regulator. And I'm using 9 volts because the receiver, the Free Sky receiver and the Dragonlink are both pulling off of that 9 volts at the end of a little power lead that runs up the wall. So that 9 volts just kind of in the middle of where they overlapped within the acceptable voltage range that the Free Sky receiver can take, as well as the Dragonlink. So 9 volts was a good happy medium that works. So, but like I said, besides getting it off of the transmitter, off of my actual radio, putting the Dragonlink module up higher on the wall obviously gets a better signal out to the airplane, and also a better signal back, telemetry back to it. It'll be able to receive it a little bit better. And the reason I wanted to finally get around, it's something I wanted to do for a long time, like years I wanted to, but I just never got around to it because it worked. But lately I've been kind of annoyed the way the my new radios, because I do really, really like flying with both of these radios, the T16 and TX16S, but they don't play well with the Dragonlink. They don't like that UHF noise. So this solves that problem. But getting back to what I was saying, the reason I'm kind of getting all this fine-tuned and ready to go and everything, this Dragonlink setup, is so that my future bills can use the Dragonlink receivers that I recently ordered, the 1-watt. So we will have RG-plane telemetry on those. So that's going to be fun. And obviously there's been some HD footage in the video by now. When during editing I'll put it in. So they're actually recording with the GoPro Hero 4 Black. I think I'm running in 2.7K at wide field of view, 30 FPS. I don't even think I switched it to 60 FPS. I believe it's still on 30. But yeah, it's just nice to get the old Skyhunter out. Now, before this flight, I updated the Dragonlink module as well as the receiver in the Skyhunter. I have the latest firmware on both of those. And also the Vector, I was a few revisions behind on firmware on the Vector. I've updated it to the latest firmware, which sadly I'm assuming is going to be the last update, because obviously they have went out of business now. They closed up shop, Eagle Tree. So I don't expect any future firmware updates. So I'm going to go ahead and cancel this now. We're kind of loitering over my antennas.
Heading mode active.
We're just going to cancel that waypoint mission and I guess just maybe fly the rest of the battery out. We're already at 3200 milliamp hours and 14.5 volts. So I'm not going to go far. These are some old LiPo batteries. In fact, these are over 8 years old now. There's some high-end hard cased 20C, I think, 4S 5000 LiPos. I actually bought these to go in my old Skywalker 1900 when I first built it, like I said, over 8 years ago. And I've used them over the years in the Skyhunter and the Skywalker. And they perform flawlessly. I mean, I'm not sure if I want to push them all the way to 5,000 milliamp hours. But, like I said, I don't like to push them past about 4,000, so we're not going to go real far. But, I'm just going to go ahead and maybe... is my throttle active? It is not. Now it is. Okay, I have control over my throttle now. What I want to see is if I trigger a failsafe with my transmitter manually, if I have manual control over the throttle or not. I don't remember how that works with the vector.
Return to launch.
Okay, so we're going to go return to launch with the vector. Now, my throttle is at idle and the vector is managing my throttle, so that's a good thing. I just wanted to know if I need to adjust my failsafe position on my radios. Right now, I do have it set at a cruise throttle, but it seems it should be safe to go ahead and set that at idle, which would be preferable for safety on the ground, at least. So if I discontinue my return to launch,
stabilization.
Yeah, my throttle goes back to idle. So if I go back to return to launch, then it's gonna throttle right back up. So that's a good thing. I actually do need to lower my cruise throttle because I did rerun the receiver wizard in the vector after I updated the firmware, and I also changed up some things in the receiver when I updated its firmware. I did run the
stabilization
signal.
Heading port active.
I reran the receiver wizard so it changed my cruise throttle and climb throttle settings, so I do need to manually readjust those. Let me see, actually I want to set my cruise for about 8 amps or so. Now I can actually look at my radio and see what, I think there may be a way to do it in the vector menu, but I'm not going to get mixed up in that right now while I'm kind of getting toward the end of the battery. I'm just going to look at my radio, see what my channel output is right now for channel 3. Actually, it's not going to show that. I need to go here, channel monitor. Channel 3 is cruise at 8.5 amps is 1490 microseconds. 1500 is close enough. Let me see what 1500 is in terms of amps. Doesn't really change much. There we go, 8.7, 8.6 amps. That'll work. That's fine. So yeah, and then my climb throttle, I want to run about 20 amps, should be more than adequate. That is 1650 microseconds. So now that I'll have a note of that I can review in the video later. I can go back and set that up. Now I kind of forgot where it was, where my train of thought was at now. But yeah, I can manually go back. I can set my throttle on my relay receiver failsafe to idle, and that will be fine. And I already know there's no pulses on the Dragonlink receiver failsafe, so that's fine. So that's just a few changes I need to make, just to finish up all the firmware updates and reconfiguration and stuff like that. So I guess at this point I can actually disable heading hold and cut the power and start gliding, and we'll be close to 4,000 milliamp hours soon enough. So I'll go ahead and cut the flight now. I'm just happy to get a flight underway. We've been in the air for 20 minutes. That'll make a video that is a little bit too long, but hopefully you'll enjoy watching it to the end anyway. But yeah, like I said, the hurricane stuff is over with now. We got power back. We repaired the shed. One of our sheds lost about half of its roof. We actually repaired that today, finished it up. Well, my dad did most of the work, but we cut up a tree. We lost a tree, went down in the front yard. It actually hit the front of the house, but luckily it didn't damage it. It just kind of made a lot of noise, and left a mess in the yard, but we cleaned that up. Like I said, the biggest problem was the 3 days and, well, 4 days almost without electricity. That was rather annoying. But, you know, it's not going to kill us. We made it. And we burned a lot of gas on the generator. Going to keep the freezers and refrigerator and everything going over that 3 day span. But no one's hurt or anything like that. Could have been a lot worse, obviously. And I absolutely cannot see my runway with the glare, the sun. I'm not sure if I'm going to land this way or if I'm going to come around. See an oak tree there. Yeah, I can make the runway. I can make it out now. There's actually not much wind at all. So I could have came around and landed the other way just fine. And that's, speaking of the hurricane, there's my new shed right out there, which is going to be walled in and turned into the hangar for the ultralight, the old Quicksilver. It's sitting in there now. And that project should get back underway pretty soon. I do need to finish walling that in before I do all the new fabric on the airplane so that it's not out exposed to the weather, to the elements. But I got a call from the lady making my new sails today. She's actually got started on them, got all the materials. She said they should be done in about a week, sometime mid next week, and then they will be shipped to me after that. But like I said, I won't get started on it until I finish walling that building in, so I can keep the airplane out of the weather. So anyway, back to the ultralight. I may not make it this flying season. Probably going to be a winter project, and maybe we'll get to fly it next year. But in the meantime, we'll do a lot more RC flying. So I'm just happy to get back in the air. Got everything kind of back into normal routine. So thank you for watching the video. Keep an eye out for what's to come. Rambled on long enough. Gonna end it here. So see you in the next video. Thank you to all the patrons, people who use affiliate links, to all the people that send me stuff for review, all that, you know, the good stuff. Yeah, we'll see you in the next video.